number of participants, and we really enjoyed that very much. And I hope you did enjoy it as well. And to save time, I just hand over to Tom Santarius, who is going to introduce the first lecturer.
Thank you, Vladimir. We were all introduced yesterday, so we won't be doing any major introductions. The first speaker will be Professor Roy Daniel, who is currently in Geneva, is Professor Vice Chairman, as you can see on the slide, originally from Kerala, with a main interest in skull base and vascular surgery, but a major past clinical interest as well as research interest in neurosciences related to epilepsy surgery, and he'll be talking about this subject now. Roy,
thank you. Thank you, Tom. I'll just go on straight to my presentation. I'll be speaking to you on the white matter anatomy in epilepsy surgery, so essentially dealing with pediatric epilepsy surgery and that too disconnective surgery, and concentrating on the white matter anatomy, so there will not be much physiology or surgical details in this presentation. So what are the, just to give a brief outline, what are the goals of epilepsy surgery? The main idea is to eliminate seizures, but because we're doing this predominantly in children, what happens is that they are allowed to develop properly cognitive functions and other functions. And at the same time, we should make sure that there are no new neurological deficits. So what it achieves is that you can reintegrate these children into society. So if, to put it simplistically, you have one hemisphere or part of a hemisphere completely destroyed by the epileptic disease. So you want to completely destroy this hemisphere, which is already destroyed, but you want to completely disconnect it so that that cannot propagate epilepsy. But what it effectively does is that the other hemisphere develops and into a double hemisphere. So all the cognitive functions and general functions develop in the normal, the good hemisphere. So that's essentially the idea of this surgery. So there are several techniques for epilepsy surgery. The simple ones are the lesionectomy and lobectomy. But then you have all these disconnective techniques, that's lobotomy, quadrantotomy, hemispherotomy, interhemispheric disconnection, and then some special applications for VNS and radiosurgery. But this lecture is primarily dedicated to anatomy and therefore disconnective epilepsy surgery, which includes lobotomy, quadrantotomy, and larger disconnective surgeries. So that's what we're focusing on. This presentation is based on the five principal publications that we have done with the description of these techniques. So just to put it into perspective, we are talking of the prefrontal lobotomy, the anterior quadrantotomy, the posterior quadrantotomy, and then hemispherotomy, which is one whole hemisphere. And then for disconnecting between the two hemispheres, which is a total commissurotomy. So these papers will give you the details of the physiology and the clinical details and the microsurgical details. I will not be talking on that in this presentation, but you could go back to these papers to look at the details of the surgery. So what is hemispherotomy? Hemispherotomy is done when one whole hemisphere is completely destroyed by the disease. And therefore, what you want to do is a radical hemispheric tractotomy. So you section the internal capsule in its entire length, and then from inside the ventricle, you completely disconnect the corpus callosum from inside, and then you go and disconnect the fornix to deafferent the temporal lobe. And then there are some parts of the frontal lobe that need to be addressed through a frontobasal disconnection, because there are some connections through the commissure, anterior commissure, that are residual. So this effectively deafferents the entire hemisphere and achieves a cessation of seizures in more than 90% of patients. So let's go to the cadaveric white mitt dissection study that we performed in Pablo Gonzalez's lab in Alicante, Spain. And just to show you the anatomy, because that's the focus of this talk. So the anterior quadrant is the lobe which is anterior to the primary motor strip, as you can see here. So that's the central sulcus, and then everything from the premotor to all the whole prefrontal lobe is the anterior quadrant. So these are children who have a normal motor function and all function in these lobes intact, but this lobe, the frontal lobe anterior to the precentral sulcus, is diseased. And so it involves a disconnection of that lobe. As you can see here, the F1, F2, and F3 on the cortical surface. And if you look at this lobe medially, you will see the genu of the corpus callosum, the rostrum, and the body. And then you have the cingulate sulcus here, the subcallosal sulcus, and the gyrus rectus you can see here. And if you look at it from the basal view, and this is an interesting view, and you see these sulci here, you see these three sulci here that divide the basal frontal lobe into four. So you have the anterior and the posterior, the medial and lateral foronto-orbital gyri. And the anatomy of these gyri are very important to make sure that the mesial and basal frontal lobes are disconnected. So as you go deeper in the disconnection, you first remove from the lateral surface, you remove all the gray matter, and that shows you the short association fibers, which are called the U fibers, that connect adjoining gyri that can be seen in this section. And then as you go deeper, when you remove the U fibers, you see the first long association fibers, the most dorsal part, which is the SLF, superior longitudinal fasciculus, and that too only the top part of it, the SLF1. And that you can find approximately just deep to the middle frontal gyrus. So the middle frontal gyrus is here, just deep to that you have the dorsal part of the SLF, which is the SLF1. And then you go ahead and remove that, you start seeing the extreme capsule. And once, if, to see that, you need to remove a part of the lobe here, which also shows you the insula. So the extreme capsule is basically a series of fibers that connect the insula to the operculum, essentially all around, and they form the extreme capsule. So as you go deeper to that, you will start seeing the external capsule. And then we proceed with the disconnection, with the dissections, and you start removing those structures. You see very important tracks here. One is the external capsule. As you start removing it, you start seeing the uncinate fasciculus and the IFOF. Inferior frontal occipital fasciculus, so which connects the frontal lobe with a large stream of connections to the posterior part of the brain, and the uncinate fasciculus, which connects the inferior part of the frontal lobe, the frontal pole, with the temporal pole and some fibers to the amygdala. So these are the structures you would see as soon as you do the dissection there. And as you go deeper, when you remove part of the IFOF and the uncinate fasciculus, you'll start seeing the frontopontine fibers, which are part of the anterior part of the internal capsule. And you can see its relation up to the putamen here. You remove part of it, it's composed, the internal capsule, the anterior part has three components. So the most lateral, it's organized lateral to medial. The most lateral part is the frontopontine fibers. And then just medial to that, you have an ascending system. So frontopontine is descending. And just medial to that, you have the thalamocorticals. So from the anterior thalamic nuclei to the prefrontal lobe, which is ascending. And then you start removing it, you see the third component, which is the frontostriatal fibers. They're from the frontal lobe to the striatum. So these are the three fibers. And when you remove a little bit of the frontostriatal fibers, you see the blue structure, which is the ependymoma of the ventricle. So these are sequential dissections that show you the anatomy of the region. If you want to see all three components together of the internal capsule, this magnified slice shows you that's the frontopontine. And then you have the thalamocortical fibers, which have been sectioned partly here. You can see the cross section here, which allows you to see the frontostriatum. Now, note the disconnection. It goes curvilinear there, and that's to avoid getting into the anterior part of the putamen and the caudate nucleus. So it has to go, when you cut the internal capsule, it has to be cut in a curvilinear manner there. And then as it goes below the disconnection onto the frontobasal disconnection, you'll be effectively interrupting the IFOF and the uncinate fasciculus. So these are views that show you the transition of the corona radiator and the internal capsule that you see there. And again, note the curvilinear manner in which you do the section of the internal capsule. Now this incision is made here to cut essentially the SLF and all the fibers that start from the front lobe and go posteriorly to the central, to the parietal and the occipital lobe. Now, once you've done the entire section of the internal capsule, what you see will be inside the ventricle. And then in the ventricle, if you look at the roof of the ventricle, you'll see the corpus callosum, the body of the corpus callosum, for instance. So this is just to show you the inside of the ventricle. So imagine that the corona radiator or internal capsule is completely cut. That's why you're seeing the ventricle. And then inside the ventricle, you will do in a parasagittal plane, the callosotomy. Now you can compare that to the medial view that kind of describes that. That's where the callosum is done. And the callosotomy is performed in this direction for the body, the genu, and the rostrum. So that is allows you to disconnect the frontal lobe almost completely. The only part that's left is the connections of the anterior commissure. Now the anterior commissure is a very interesting anatomical structure. It has got two limbs. It's got the posterior limb and the anterior limb. The anterior limb, it connects essentially this cortex, the frontal basal cortex, and the posterior limb actually goes behind into the temporal horn and goes even more posterior. So these two structures, the anterior commissure is disconnected here as part of the frontobasal disconnection, and that completes the entire disconnection of the cortex, the frontal lobe, essentially. Now, this is a very interesting view, but it's a little more difficult to understand because this is the base of the brain. But a lot of part of the base of the brain has been removed. So, and you remove it so that you can see the inside the ventricle. So that's the body of the corpus callosum that you see in the depth there. So there's a cavity of the ventricle here. That shows you the relationship with the anterior commissure, which is very superficial in this case. And this is where that needs to be cut, as you can see here, to disconnect the basal and mesial parts from the frontal lobe. So to make it in a schematic view, this is the surgery. You do the intrafrontal disconnection that disconnects the frontal from all the other lobes. And then you go inside the ventricle, the corpus callosum is cut, and then you come down and you disconnect the anterior commissure that completely disconnects the anterior frontal lobe. So a slight variation of this with some differences in the anatomy that we had recently published is the prefrontal lobotomy. So the prefrontal lobotomy is unilateral, it's not bilateral, and that was only done many years back for psychiatric disease, but this is for epilepsy and it's unilateral, so we don't expect any psychiatric changes in these patients because that prefrontal lobe is already diseased and is not having any useful function. So in this one, it's very similar to the anterior quadrantotomy, but there's some anatomical things that could be interesting. Just to show you its bony relationship, that's a superior temporal line, that's the terion there. A small craniotomy, which is an extension of a terional craniotomy, if you will, which is more frontal and had no temporal. It gives you exposure of the top of the sylvian fissure and the middle and the inferior and the middle frontal gyri. This is the disconnection plane. So what needs to be seen here in this prefrontal lobotomy is to see the gyri of the frontal operculum. That's the pars orbitalis, pars triangularis, and pars opercularis. So it is between these two, the last two, that we start making the disconnection. In the depth, in the basal surface, we already described the basal gyri of the frontal lobe. On the mesial surface, you can see that the body of the corpus callosum is not cut. It's only the anterior part, the rostrum, and the genu, which is cut in this operation. Quickly run you through the five, again, U fibers we already described. You see the dorsal SLF that comes there. The corona, as when you remove that, you see the corona radiator and its transition with the putamen, and you see the IFOF, the uncinate vesicle. And if you keep removing that and part of the putamen, you would even see the anterior commissure. So, I think this slide shows you the anterior commissure with respect to the transition of the corona radiator internal capsule. The putamen has partly been moved aside and the inferior frontal lobe has been removed a little bit because this represents the limit of the frontobasal disconnection. So from a mesial side, the frontobasal disconnection, again, you see it is only the rostrum and the genu that is disconnected. And here you see how we have to go across the olfactory tract and see the gyrus rectus to make sure that the mesial frontal lobe is completely disconnected. So this is just a view to show you inside the ventricle, the difference between getting the cutting the corpus, the corona radiator, and cutting the corpus callosum. It's in the roof of the ventricle, the corpus callosum, and that needs to be sectioned to achieve disconnection from the other hemisphere. So that was for the prefrontal and anterior frontal, anterior quadrant. But then what do you do when you have children with epilepsy that comes from both hemispheres? So this is a large series that we published with work done with Professor Sufyanov in Tumen, Russia. So these were essentially all patients there. And then we did also a series of disconnections, which I'm going to focus on. So we're trying to disconnect one hemisphere from the other. So we are not deafferenting the hemisphere. It's only it's a commissural disconnection only. So here, the series of disconnections that we did give rise to, dissections that we did give rise to some interesting images. And Henry showed part of it yesterday, but it's important to realize that the patient is positioned with the head turned completely. And so it's not the usual position for a ventriculocisternostomy. So the head is turned completely and you go orthogonal to the brain surface. And then you reach the ventricle. And then we are using flexible endoscopes, so which gives you this view. And this view is only possible, don't imagine like a ventriculocisternostomy. This is a view of a flexible endoscope that is inside the ventricle. So imagine you're standing inside the ventricle and looking forwards. So when you look forwards, what you see is the two foramen of Monroe, the choroid plexus you can see there, and you have these two large columns of the fornix. And between the two, forming almost equilateral triangle, is the anterior commissure. And then as you look inferior, you will see the lamina terminalis, and then you will see the optic chiasma here, and the infundibular recess. So this is a view from inside the ventricle with a flexible scope. Now, if you just turn around, you move the flexible scope posteriorly. So you're standing inside the ventricle and you're looking posteriorly, you see these incredible images of the posterior commissure. And then you see the suprapineal recess here, the pineal recess here and the suprapineal recess here. So the pineal recess is bordered superiorly by the habenular commissure and inferiorly by the posterior commissure. And above the habenular commissure, you get the suprapineal recess. And there you start seeing the choroid plexus of the roof of the third ventricle. So the velum interpositum and the roof of the third ventricle, and it continues anteriorly. And then as you go inferiorly, you'll start seeing the the aqueduct of Sylvius. So this is the image from inside the ventricle. And this was just dissections to show, again, reinforce the idea of the anterior commissure. And you see the anterior limb there and the posterior limb there. And you see it, the structure that's parallel to the optic chiasma. And those are the mammary bodies. So this is a view from the basal surface of the brain. And then our dissections led us to completely follow these fibers all around, all the way here. And this shows you, for instance, in violet, the connections of the anterior commissure with parts of the temporal lobe. So just to show that this is not just one structure there, it connects the entire hemisphere almost. So a view from the midline. Now this is a more familiar view for everybody in neurosurgery. So where are the anterior and posterior commissure? So this is the anterior commissure and this is the posterior commissure. And this is the hypothalamic sulcus, which divides the hypothalamus from the hypothalamus here from the thalamus there. And then you see the site of the fornix. Then you see how the corpus callosum, the rostrum of the corpus callosum, almost completely blends into the anterior commissure. And there, inferior to that, you see the anterior wall of the third ventricle, which is the lamina terminalis. And then you get the infundibular recess here and the optic recess here, these two. And then as you go posteriorly, you see the mammary body, the posterior perforated substance, the tegmentum of the midbrain, and the tectum. So this is an oblique view that kind of shows almost the same structures, but again, anterior commissure, the posterior commissure, and the habenular commissure here. So quickly run you through a video. I hope I have enough time. This is the video just to show you this anatomy, which is so unusual to see. Now this, we are going through one foramen of Monroe and going to the next one. And so there, as you go inside, you will see the anterior commissure. So there, this fiber tract here, which is between the two foramina Monroe, is the anterior commissure. So that's the section of the anterior commissure. I'll run the video little more posteriorly, and you turn it around and you come across to the posterior commissure. That's the That's the posterior commissure. What you saw before was the roof of the third ventricle. Again, that's the posterior commissure. Then inside the lateral ventricle, you use the rigid scope, and that's the corpus callosum. That's the roof of the lateral ventricle, and you slowly disconnect the entire corpus callosum from anterior to posterior. You can cut with this monopolar or bipolar, and then progressively disconnect the entire corpus callosum in a parasagittal plane. See, that's the method of disconnection of the corpus callosum. So what did we do for the posterior quadrant? I'll quickly run through that, but essentially the posterior quadrant, to dissect it and to understand it and to operate here, we need to understand the telencephalic flexion. So the embryology is fascinating here. It's essentially I want to focus on the development of the telencephalon, and these flexures you can see here, but the telencephalon starts developing disproportionately proportionate to the rest of the brain. It's not always the case. We look at the telencephalon in rats, it's almost straight. In sheep as well, there's a small turn, and then you see in primates that it just takes a bigger turn, and in humans it's completely turned here. What's fascinating to realize is that when it started off, the telencephalon, the frontal lobe was anterior, and the temporal lobe was posterior, and the parieto-occipital was somewhere in between. But as we started developing the flexure, what happened is that at the end of the game, the temporal lobe became very anterior. So it started off as a very posterior structure and ended up with a relatively anterior location. And what was not posterior before, which is the occipital lobe, is now firmly posterior. So we, during the COVID crisis, we had a lot of time, me and Pablo. So Pablo did some fantastic dissections of the posterior quadrant in Alicante that shows you the U fibers here, and it shows you from the medial surface the relationship of the splenium and the isthmus here, which is found at the junction of the parahippocampal gyrus, the lingula, and the cingulum that has been removed in this case. And what is essential is to realize these two points here, which is the post crural point where the two fornix almost joins and touches the corpus callosum, and the retrohippocampal point there. And once we understand the anatomy of these two points, we can understand a lot about the telencephalic flexure. So in conclusion, I just quickly described to you the anatomy, white matter anatomy of the hemispherotomy, which is the whole hemisphere, and it needs to be completely disconnected, the entire hemisphere. A small part, if you want to do, of the prefrontal lobe, and then the anterior quadrantotomy, which is almost the entire frontal lobe, the posterior quadrantotomy, which disconnects the temporal, parietal, and occipital lobes. This work is, a lot of it is done in different places, Alicante, Tumen, and Switzerland. The Zoom experience has been great, but we sorely miss the other activities of the neuroanatomy committee, and I hope we can restart that soon. Thank you.
Roy, thank you very much for your great talk. Amazing how much you managed to cover in such a relatively short period of time. While the next speaker is getting ready, we'll have several questions here. In fact, the first one was from Francisco Alberto Villegas Lopez. I hope I pronounced your name correctly. How to avoid damage to thalamus in frontal lobectomy? Roy, could you tell us?
Well, in frontal lobectomy, I think it's essentially the realization of when you enter into the ventricle. So once you disconnect frontal lobectomy for epilepsy or for any other disease, once you cut the internal capsule or the coronal radiator internal capsule junction and you enter the ventricle, after that you have to follow you'll see the intraventricular structures, the caudate nucleus in front and the thalamus more posterior. So at that point, it's difficult to injure it. So as long as you stay oriented by the intraventricular anatomy, thalamic injury should not occur.
And another question was related to vision, where, I suppose you could paraphrase the question, you know, where and in which operation vision is at risk, and what steps do you take? How do you think of the operation in order to avoid damage to vision?
Well, if you're talking about epilepsy surgery per se, and especially pediatric epilepsy surgery, the lobes that we're disconnecting do not have any function. So even if there is on very detailed and minute testing, the visual fields or the sensitivity between the fields, you might get some deficits. They are rarely symptomatic because these children kind of adapt, and the visual cortices of the other hemisphere kind of subserve almost the entire field. So it is never a problem when you are contemplating pediatric epilepsy surgery, because these are all diseases that occur in utero during early part of development of the brain. So the visual cortex has, like all cortices, have a remarkable capacity to adjust. The only cortex which does not have a capacity to adjust is the motor strip, the motor cortex. And that becomes predominantly relevant for the movement of the distal extremities. So essentially movement of the hands or movements of the foot tapping. So these are the only function that we lose if it already existed. But these children who have hemiplegias, for whom we look at doing a hemispherotomy, they don't have any distal motor function, so you lose nothing. But if it is there and you were to do a disconnection of that lobe, you will lose it, but that's the rarity. As we